Hello, I'm Gloria Macarenko. Well, here we are in phase two of the pandemic, which means some things are more open, but we remain mostly at home. This is our Vancouver Apart Together. Coming up, despite distance, connections stay strong between Indigenous SFU students and the university elder. And keeping off the quarantine 15, how to make better snack choices. But first, valued viewing, a treasure trove of home movies from Japanese Canadians. Well, by now you may have exhausted your list of Netflix films as you've been staying mostly at home. Well, here is something else to consider. Home movies of Japanese Canadian families in BC. An extensive collection of home movies has been assembled by the Nikkei National Museum and Cultural Center. And Lisa Uyeda is the collections manager. Lisa, hello there.
Hello, how are you?
I am doing really well. So where did the idea come from to collect home movies from local families?
Well, our community archives at the Nikkei National Museum plays a big role in helping us achieve our mandate to honor, preserve, and share Japanese culture and Japanese Canadian history and heritage for a better Canada. So it's part of our mandate to preserve and make these accessible.
Okay, you're speaking very broadly here now, Lisa. I know you have to set it up for us. I want specifics. What do we see?
So our oldest films date to the 1920s, and they were donated to us by Kei Kaminishi, who you may know is the last surviving member of the Vancouver Asahi baseball team. So they show films of the BC logging industry. His father was a partner in Royston Lumber Mill. It also shows the historic Powell Street neighborhood, which is now what we call the downtown east side. You can also see beautiful shots of the neon lights on Granville Street. And films from the Steve Sazaki collection are from the 1930s, and they capture important events in BC history. You can see women and girls dressed in formal kimono and men in suits lining Main Street by Pacific Central Station, getting ready to welcome King George VI and Queen Elizabeth during their tour to Canada in May of 1939.
So you've had a chance to peruse all of these home movies. What stood out for you personally as you're going through it? Anything surprise you?
Oh, there's lots of surprises there, but probably my favorite is truly one-of-a-kind footage of Jigoro Kano, who was the founder of judo. And he visited Canada around 1937 or 1938. And so you can see him greeting the community, visiting Gross Mountain, boarding a train to visit other cities across Canada. So it's really remarkable that we are so lucky to have this footage that captures that early part of not only judo history, but Canadian history too.
So how difficult was it for you to gather this all up and convert it and post it?
We're very lucky that we were able to get assistance from Library and Archives Canada, as well as our volunteer auxiliary, to help us raise the funds necessary to digitize these films. It took us about a year and a half, and we had to hire a conservation film technician to prepare these films because they've been sitting for, you know, almost 100 years. So depending on their storage conditions, they were in disarray or quite playable. So we are lucky to prepare them, send them off for digitization, and then get them back so that we can share them for free online with the public.
So why is this important for you personally, you know, to keep this record and to save these images for future generations?
Yeah, I think what is most remarkable is the fact that these films have survived for almost 100 years. Captured in the Tomojiro Inoue films, which survived the forced uprooting and dispossession of Japanese Canadians from the West Coast during the Second World War. These family films documented their everyday life in Paldi on Vancouver Island before the war, their life in the Lemon Creek internment camp where they lived in a shack, and their second uprooting to Vernon before their rights as citizens were restored in 1949. So these films capture a remarkable time in Canadian history, and we see that in other documents like photographs and diaries, but film just brings it to life. And it allows you to watch and to relate to those experiences that much more.
Oh, for sure. Well, it's wonderful. It's going to be accessible to all. But how do you think this kind of footage could be used in the future?
Well, we're hoping that the schools will be able to use them to help educate this part of Canadian history. There's lots of opportunities for documentaries, online websites that might have more of an educational twist. But I think, you know, the sky's the limit. They could be used within art installations, galleries, exhibits. So I think there's quite a lot that can happen with these films.
Well, thank you very much for this little preview. We'll have to check it out more in depth in the future. Lisa, thank you.
Thank you so much, Gloria.
Hi, I'm Irene.
Hi, I'm Kevin.
Yeah, here is Xian. You are watching Our Vancouver.
Okay, it's time for one of our favorite features when we get to showcase a number of the photographs that are sent in by you, our audience. And our BC Photos email has been filling up more now than ever before. Renee Warren captured this heron in flight on Burnaby Mountain. Amazing timing there, Renee, thank you. And Roseanne Kufeld spent some time at Wreck Beach at Pacific Spirit Park. Looks so lovely there. Marie Dixon was at Gary Point Park in Richmond just as the sun was setting. Wonderful. Thank you, Marie. And finally, Winnie Liu took some images at the very peaceful Belcarra Regional Park. We love that, Winnie. Thanks for sharing. And do send us more while you're out and about with your camera. Email your photographs to bcphotos@cbc.ca. That's all one word, bcphotos@cbc.ca. Now, since so many of us are sticking close to home, we have asked Canada's best nature cinematographers to capture stunning scenes from the natural world. So we have filled a web page with this content. It is called Hello Spring, and we're hoping that our audience is going to enjoy it and contribute as well. So you could send your springtime photographs and videos by posting them on Twitter, on Facebook, or on Instagram, and just use the hashtag HelloSpringCBC. Hashtag HelloSpringCBC. Well, we can't wait to see all of that, but first, some of the filmmaker's video, which includes hummingbirds and cherry blossoms, and this film of herons in Stanley Park. Thank you. A BC marine biologist has been recognized for her work protecting seahorses around the world. Not only is UBC Professor Amanda Vincent this year's recipient of the prestigious Indianapolis Prize, which recognizes conservationists, she is also taking the roughly $350,000 award that comes with the prize. Just take a look.
In seahorses, only the male gets pregnant, and that's got to intrigue most of us. But while I was doing that work, I suddenly realized that there was a massive global trade in these animals and wanted to know more.
Coming up, inspiration to get you moving after a sluggish 2 months of quarantine. Watching Our Vancouver Apart Together. It's a program on how we are all coping through COVID-19. I'm Gloria Macarenko. Now, more than ever, we need to move our bodies. And with no end in sight, physical distancing is our new way of life. Now, it only takes 10 minutes throughout your day to move your body and recharge. Naomi Joy Gallagher, a certified fitness trainer from Vancouver, shares her daily movement routine designed for those who are sitting for long hours.
Hi, my name is Naomi Joy from Vancouver, BC, and I'm a certified fitness trainer. Today, I'm going to share with you some simple yet effective moves to do from home that are going to help you feel your best. They won't require any equipment or a large space. My regular routine is really active. I'm biking across the city, teaching multiple classes a day. My commute's a little shorter now. To stay busy, I started a YouTube channel as a way to connect with my students and to share my passion of movement. My new job requires a lot more sitting than what I'm used to, and I'm starting to feel these aches and pains my clients complain about. A lot of us are sitting more, working from home, video chatting with friends. But it takes only 10 minutes throughout your day to move your body and recharge. Let's start with breath. Take a deep breath in through your nose. Exhale through your mouth, calming your nervous system. Draw your chin in, tilt your ear to the side for a neck stretch. Hold for 30 seconds and press the opposite shoulder down. Inhale tall. Exhale switch. Soften your eyes. Relax your jaw. Elbow circles. Grounding through your feet, keep your belly strong, mobilizing the shoulder girdle, opening the chest after being on the computer all day. Let's get those endorphins flowing and not anger our neighbors. Quick and quiet feet. Have fun. This one stretches your hip flexors, which get really tight after sitting for long periods. Keep your front knee over your ankle, hips square. Tuck your tailbone under by keeping your low belly and your back glute engaged, and feel free to add that side stretch. The squat with twist. Feet shoulder width, sit back in your heels and squeeze your glutes to stand. Be mindful to not collapse your knees in. Keep your chest lifted. Twist from the belly side to side. The glute bridge is an excellent exercise to do if you've been sitting all day, as it strengthens your posterior chain. Place heels underneath knees, thighs in parallel. Push your feet into the ground, lift your hips up, tuck your tailbone under by squeezing your glutes and engage your low core. Keep the chin slightly tucked and avoid twisting your neck side to side. We can't forget about our core. With our abs wrapping in and without arching your lower back, tap one toe down. Start with bent knees and progress to straight legs. Chin is tucked, head heavy in your hands. If this irritates your neck, no problem, just lower your head.
For more challenge, a double leg lower. Bet you want to work up to this one and make sure you feel it in your abs and not your lower back. Oh, and remember to breathe.
Working out regularly not only makes you more productive, but also more pleasant and patient with your loved ones.
Now, there has been a lot of online chatter about the quarantine 15. That's the 15 pounds that people feel that they have gained since staying inside by baking bread and seeking comfort food. Well, we are in the mostly at-home pattern for the summer, if not longer. So how do we stay healthy? Hannah Rakowski is a nutritionist with Choices Markets. Hannah, hello there.
Hi, Gloria. Thank you for having me.
Well, we know that food has been a comfort to so many people during this pandemic. So how do you see it? I mean, how do you satisfy all our cravings without gaining so much extra weight?
Yes, it's been quite a battle for the majority of us, actually. So what we want to do is we want to feel full and satisfied and nourished, but not deprived. So my advice to people has been to really focus on, you know, your main meals being fiber rich and nutrient dense to help to, you know, curb those cravings for, you know, high fat, high sodium and sugary snack foods. But we can also opt for snack foods that are healthier and fiber rich and nutrient dense to help us to feel fuller for longer and also be nourished.
All right. Well, you've got some examples for us. Why don't you take us through how to make a Buddha bowl? What do you do?
So with a Buddha bowl, this is a great recipe to really, you know, maximize your fiber and nutrient intake because it's so versatile. And so what I like to do is to start with a base of whole grains or leafy greens, and then you can add a protein source such as chickpeas or beans or tofu, for example. I've used baked tofu in the recipe that's provided. And I also like to use yam wedges to create a good complex carbohydrate source for, you know, mental function, energy levels. And then you can add any veggies you have on hand, like broccoli or raw bell peppers, etc. And then what you want to do is top that with a really healthy, nutrient dense, but delicious sauce. So what I've used is a tahini garlic dressing.
That sounds lovely. Okay, but meals are one thing, and I can see where that would be filling and nutritious at the same time. But how do you keep snacks, you know, satisfying and healthy?
Great question. So what we want to do is we want to make sure that we're reaching for, you know, primarily plant-based snack foods that are high in fiber. So, for example, I have here, we have some seed crackers, hummus, and veggies, some raw veggies, and that's going to provide us with about 6 grams of fiber for half a cup of the hummus, plus about 3 grams of fiber for our raw veggies. And so fiber helps to keep us really, really full and also helps with bowel regularity, which is super important, as well as supporting our immune system with all the micronutrients in the veggies, right? We also have some roasted chickpeas. That's going to provide us with 12 grams of fiber for half a cup. And what we want to do is we want to aim for 40 grams of fiber per day. And most Canadians are actually deficient, so that's really important. And we also have a savory snack such as kale chips. Kale chips can be store-bought or homemade. Here we have, they're covered with nutritional yeast, which is high in B vitamins. And also, of course, kale is low calorie, but also provides us with vitamins and phytonutrients to support our immune system. For those of us who are more into a sweeter type snack, I like to, first of all, go for a trail mix with some dried fruit and raw nuts and seeds, like, for example, pumpkin seeds that are high in zinc, goji berries, and dates to provide a level of, you know, that instant kind of comfort food and energy for the brain. And we also like to go for something like a berry bowl, very standard, but fruit is so healthy, of course, high in fiber. If you're going to go for a cup of berries, for example, like we have blueberries and raspberries here, you're getting about 6 grams of fiber for the cup and a whole multitude of polyphenols to help support your immune function. The last snack idea that I have for those of us with a sweet tooth are energy balls. So you can actually create your own energy balls. Here I have some turmeric lemon energy balls made with hemp hearts and oats and walnuts and other nuts and seeds. And these will, of course, create that satiating feeling, but also help to satisfy any cravings that we do have.
I was just asking for a friend, of course.
Yes.
You know, when it comes to choices, what kinds of things have you guys had to change to adjust to this COVID-19 hit? I mean, in terms of nutritional classes or demos that you can offer online?
Yeah, so, you know, business as usual has changed quite vastly for us, but some things haven't changed, and that's our commitment to our customers and making sure we're all connected through educational resources. So what we've done is we've actually moved our entire wellness seminar program completely online, and anyone can register on choicesmarkets.com for those seminars. We currently have a couple more left in May and 6 more coming up in June. On our website, you can also, you know, sign up for our newsletter with upcoming events and other updates regarding the whole situation, as well as, you know, homemade recipe ideas. We've also launched a few social media initiatives now where we're featuring our nutrition team, and what they're doing is basically offering nutrition tips and recipe ideas and product highlights on our social media channels. You can also download our free vegan recipe ebook as well on our website that we've done in collaboration with Veg Expo. And we've also launched cooking tutorials in our social media channels as well.
Still staying in touch. Nice to hear. Hannah, thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Gloria.
I'm Stuart, and you're watching Our Vancouver.
While events have been canceled or postponed right now, there are many online activities created as a way to combat the COVID blues. Vancouver's Indian Summer Festival has gone online for its 10th anniversary year. There are many events to tap into, including a cast of poets from around the world reflecting on our current times. It's called It Could Be Verse, Poetry for a Pandemic, and that takes place May 30th. And the first ever Kids Fest pop-up runs from Tuesday, May 26th to Sunday, May 31st. Parents and children and teachers will all be able to take part in daily online events that promise to delight and engage and entertain, including a drag show for kids called Home is a Drag. Well, that is very on point. So go to the Children's Festival website for all of the information.
Hey, I'm Grant Lawrence from CBC Music, and I'm at home. And while our country begins to slowly open up again, it's important to remember that Canadian musicians are still at home as well, since venues and tours and stages will be just about the last thing that you're gonna get to be able to enjoy again in person. But musicians continue to get ever more creative from home in their quarantunes efforts, including supercuts. Artists and celebrities from across the country coming together in song. And those supercuts have come a long way in a very short time. Here's a rather infamous one from just 6 days into the North American quarantine, as organized by Hollywood actress Gal Gadot, aka Wonder Woman.
Imagine there's no heaven. It's easy if you try.
No hell below us.
Above us only sky.
Imagine all the people
living for today. Yeah.
Great intentions, but not even Wonder Woman could save that a cappella version of Imagine, which was met with confusion and general disdain from audiences. But quarantine super edits have since found their way, especially when they involve, you know, actual musicians and singers, like this recent all-star Canadian pop tribute to the late American songwriter Bill Withers.
You need to borrow, for no one can feel those of your needs that you won't let show.
Yes, that's how you do it. Leave it to Canadians to show them how it's done, eh? All proceeds from that single are being donated to the Canadian Red Cross to help fight COVID-19 in Canada. But the great Canadian quarantine supercuts don't stop there. Here is another coast-to-coast collection of Canadian roots rock stars coming together on a classic song by the band. And yes, this is Barney Bentall on his horse at his ranch in the Caribou region of BC. Check it out.
Take a load off Fanny. Take a load for free. Take a load off Fanny. And put the load right on me.
There you go. That's a coast-to-coast, together-in-isolation performance of The Weight, originally by the band, put together by the Great Canadian Kitchen Party. That's a charitable organization dedicated to uniting Canadians through music, food, and sport. Three of my favorite things, I'm sure probably three of your favorites too. And did you spot Jim Cuddy from Blue Rodeo in that supercut performing with his kids, Devin and Sam? Well, Jim Cuddy is also at the heart of our next and final quarantine supercut, and this one comes to you courtesy of your very own CBC. A few weeks ago, CBC Music asked you what song should Canadians sing along to in times like this, and the consensus amongst music fans was Blue Rodeo's timeless classic, Lost Together. So with Jim Cuddy and Greg Keeler leading hundreds of you, here's the results. Okay, I'm completely biased, but that song chokes me up every time. That is the Great Canadian Sing-Along from CBC Music featuring Blue Rodeo's Lost Together and that very special version created in the spirit of coming together in a time of crisis is a song that you need to add to your Quarantunes playlist for this week. I'm Grant Lawrence. Stay safe, stay healthy, keep Canadian music alive, and I'll check in with you again next week.
Coming up, physically distant, but very much in touch. SFU elder support continues through COVID-19. Watching Our Vancouver Apart Together. I'm Gloria Macarenko. Now, there's a program that aims to connect young Indigenous students at Simon Fraser University with elder support. But since the pandemic, the program has really fallen silent. The problem is, with many students forced away from their communities, the need to help and connect is even larger. As Gordon Loveran of our Urban Nations unit reports, technology is helping to bridge that divide.
It's usually a room that's bursting with life, but these days it's gone silent. The Elders Lounge, a stark reminder of the new normal during the COVID-19 pandemic, and a real challenge for those supporting Indigenous students at SFU.
We've had to move our services like everybody else off campus. So over the last 6 weeks, the ISC team has worked together to develop programming and supports for Indigenous learners remotely. And the latest and newest part of that programming is with our elders program.
I'm not technically inclined with computer technology, and I was really happy to connect with all of them.
In normal times, elders were getting over 4,000 visits from Indigenous students in a single school year.
I do want to ensure that they feel connected. I want to make sure that we're checking in and supporting their mental health.
I'm not able to even go home to visit my family right now because of what's going on. And then two, like all of these activities have kind of had to have a halt.
Of us dealing with classes remotely and trying to navigate that, and then not even being able to, be able to reach the supports that we're used to.
Zoom, an online meeting app, has replaced the Elders Lounge as a place of comfort. And just like before the pandemic, an elder is able to once more offer sage advice.
We just need to be talking about what we're doing and how we're, keeping occupied so that we're not dwelling in fear.
How we get our students to successfully get through this institution, get their degrees with their heart, spirit, and minds intact. That's my goal.
Gordon Lovren, CBC News, Vancouver.
Concerts, clubs, and music festivals as we know them are off the table, at least for the time being. And that means a lot of musicians have lost a significant part of their income. Well, Vancouver musician Lydia Hall recently hosted her first online show. She also spoke to Stephen Quinn of the Early Edition and played a tune.
So great to hear you. How are you holding up?
I'm doing all right. Yeah.
We've heard from the province, of course, that concerts, large gatherings, likely are not going to happen in BC for the rest of this year. They just don't want to put that many people into one room. Premier John Horgan said that big events are conditional on a vaccine or medical treatments. I mean, as a musician, what does it feel like to hear that news?
I mean, it's definitely not news that I think any of us were ever expecting to hear in our lifetimes. But, people are trying to find new solutions. And I think that one of the things that's being distilled is how important and special gathering together for live music is. And that's, I think, been something when I've talked to colleagues and other musicians, that it's really wonderful to see people already starting to come up with creative solutions to make sure that we can still gather, whether that's in like a drive-in concert setting that I think some people have already started talking about, whether that's online. But I think just hearing how special and meaningful that piece of people's lives is and how they're missing that is, it's really nice to hear.
Now, speaking of which, you've got a new song out today, and you actually wrote it before the COVID pandemic, but coincidentally, it kind of fits it perfectly right now. It's called Let the Light In. You're going to perform that for us. Would you like to set it up before you start?
Yeah, sure. I wrote this song. It's on my new record that's going to be coming out later this year. And it's funny, it's not a song particularly that I was expecting to release as the kind of a single or anything like that, but it just, as soon as this whole shift happened, this song kept coming to my mind, and I just felt like I needed to release it and share it, because it just really kind of, it talks about exactly what we're going through right now, and I hope it asks people to kind of react in positive and generous ways.
All right, Lydia Hall, Let the Light In, take it away. In the pendulum swing.
Coming up, a segment that we are calling Remember When. You are watching Our Vancouver, a part together. I'm Gloria Macarenko. Now, since the pandemic, we have chosen a story from our past to show again. 6 years ago, our skies were getting filled with little aerial vehicles or drones. From hobbyists to commercial users, the machines began to give us a view of the world that we just hadn't seen before. Chris Brown brought us that story.
A new age of unmanned flight is starting to soar.
I'll tell you, the last 6 months has just been totally phenomenal.
The things that are happening are going to change the way we think and the way we live.
Now anyone can be a pilot and shoot incredible video.
I'm loving it. It's like a dream come true. Like all this technology certainly didn't exist 6 or 7 years ago.
But in this aerial free-for-all, who's to say what might come crashing down and what might be underneath?
When it comes to unmanned aerial vehicles, it seems the sky really is the limit. In many cases, they're way cheaper than a helicopter, and we're only just learning all the things they can be used for. Plus, for many people, there's an undeniable cool factor. Still, having a sky full of cameras could also be a nuisance.
Another term with a more hostile connotation for these unmanned craft is, of course, drones. First pioneered by the US military, the same technology is now usable by anyone.
My name's Noel Rubin, and I am a helicopter and drone enthusiast. And this is my custom drone, which I've built, and I absolutely enjoy flying this thing.
My name is Emil de Guzman. What I have here is a DJI Phantom, the version 1. So this is capable of bringing a GoPro 3 on top in the sky, so you can get a unique bird's eye perspective.
Noel Rubin constructed his drone from a specialty kit he bought online. Total cost, $2,000.
There's actually a little mini computer, which is each one of these things, that controls each motor. It has GPS, and there's also a compass in here, so it can navigate very well. It's almost like the computer's flying this, but you're telling it where to go. I can park it in the sky. If I let go of the controls, it's literally like putting a parking brake on. And in the event of, like, if my radio conks out, or anything like that, it's programmed to return to where it landed.
Emil de Guzman's machine is one of the more popular retail models out there. Together, you can get the machine and the GoPro camera for roughly $1,000.
So this is connected to the GoPro 3. So when I'm flying, I can see where I'm flying. I use this purely for recreational uses. Every time I fly this, people always come to me and they ask me, where did you get this? Did you make this?
Canadian law treats people flying for fun and those flying for commercial purposes very differently.
Since this is a model aircraft, I don't necessarily need a permit for this.
As long as it's under 35 kilograms or roughly 70 pounds and you're flying for fun, it's a model aircraft. You have to maintain line of sight, and it can't get too close to congested or built-up areas or restricted airspace like an airport. But otherwise, hobbyists are good to fly.
Do you think there should be more regulations to control even the hobby use of these sorts of things?
I wouldn't mind even seeing, like, maybe it's like getting a license or something that people are certified that they know what they're doing, because there's a lot of science in this and there's a lot of expertise. This isn't a toy.
The drones are watching us, but who is watching the drones? After all, accidents happen.
It actually went out of signal once. I was flying at the beach and then it just, thankfully, it crashed over the tree. I got an email from a safety aviation inspector. He referenced some of my videos on YouTube and he was telling me how I flew in busy and crowded areas. He was giving me a warning, just telling me that I should be more careful in the places that I'm flying.
Imagine a sky, though, filled not with dozens or hundreds of unmanned flying vehicles, but thousands. UAV technology is getting crazy small.
What is this?
This is my little baby drone, which is just pure fun. This is a toy.
And what does it do?
It just hovers around. You can fly it indoors if you're careful, but it's just pure fun. It cannot call the camera or anything. It's just for fun.
And in the lab, the next generation of UAVs, micro aerial vehicles, or MAVs, are as small as insects and being built to do similar jobs, such as pollinating crops.
Like the coordination of these thousands of MAVs, it's a big challenge, but it is doable.
Existing Canadian legislation certainly doesn't contemplate anything like a swarm of insect drones. But increasingly, unmanned aerial vehicles are taking over Canada's airspace faster than we can figure out how to keep up with them. Chris Brown, CBC News, Vancouver.
Now, CBC Vancouver is so lucky to have two amazing still photographers on staff. And each week, Maggie McPherson and Ben Nelms capture the biggest stories in our city. So here is a series of their photos from this past week. And that's all for Our Vancouver for this week. I hope you'll be able to join me weekday afternoons on CBC Radio 1 for On the Coast. Goodbye for now. Do stay safe.